Hey everybody, it's Goji Rex, and today I have an off-the-cuff, no-script video, a dev diary for Godzilla 2000's Funny Jump for Save the Earth Melee. And if you don't know what the Funny Jump is, you can see SMG over here laying dead from when I did it earlier. That's the Funny Jump. You know it, you love it, it's from Godzilla vs. Megaguirus. In particular, I want to go over the technical aspects behind it, and talk about two even funnier glitches that occur with the Funny Jump, and my theories as to why they happen, because they are not repeatable as far as we know, and I hope to one day make them consistent variations of the Funny Jump. So first, I want to talk about a little bit what is the Funny Jump. How does it work? Well, for starters, we need to talk about the difference between Godzilla Save the Earth's jump system and Godzilla Unleashed's jump system, right? So when you jump in this game, you just do a standing jump or a run jump or a dodge, anything where you leave the ground, you aren't technically leaving the ground. It's dependent on the animation itself. It lifts the monster up in the animation, and they go a consistent distance and land at a consistent frame every time, regardless of terrain. You can see as I jump down or jump up, I'm in the air for the same amount of time, regardless, and I conform to the terrain below me. The terrain below me is always a consistent distance from my monster. In Godzilla Unleashed, it works completely differently. You actually do leave the ground, and then you fall down. And that actually is, in this game, in the form of knockback. Right? When you knock a monster over, when they hit the ground is dependent on when they literally hit the ground, and it can depend on the terrain differences from when they're knocked back to where they land. How long they're in the air for depends. It's variable. And the way that the Funny Jump works, as well as SMG's anvil drop here, is essentially self-inflicted knockback, right? So if I am all the way up here, and I do a Funny Jump to the ground that's lower, I am in the ground for a much longer period of time than if I jump onto terrain. And this is, like I said, how Godzilla Unleashed jumps work, and in particular, it's how Mogira's jumps work in Save the Earth. And I will do, hopefully, a dev diary of Mogira in the future, because there is a lot to talk about. Mogira is essentially a proto Godzilla Unleashed character in Save the Earth, and he is what allows for much of Unleashed's mechanics to make it into this game, in particular DI, right? So I can do a standing jump, and I can drift with it. I can drift forward, left, right, and everything in between, right? And that is all because of Mogira. And so too is this self-inflicted knockback. Although in this particular case, SMG here is the key to the Funny Jump. So basically how I made this work, the breakdown of how I made this work, is the Funny Jump is divided into three different states. You have a launch preparation where Godzilla squats down and prepares to launch himself. I mean, the title is what it is, right? And then you have the rise upwards animation, and then you have the fall down. When he reaches slightly before the apex of his jump, he goes into a static pose, and that is when the hitbox actually activates, slightly before the apex, so that you can use it to hit people out of the air on your rise up. Well, that was a complete miss. We'll try and time that a little better. Like this. And that hitbox is the same hitbox on the fall down. So I'm going to do a frame by frame so you can see a bit more of what I'm talking about. If I do my launch, I press both triggers, I begin to squat down. And then you can see when I drift forward, you can see the beginning of the momentum start to kick in. And now I'm in the rising animation. And then he will settle into a pose right before the apex, right here. When he does this, the hitbox is now active. And these animations, like I mentioned, how Godzilla Unleashed's jump works, these animations are actually his unleashed jump. Not the pose, mind you, but the launch and the rise up. This is what it looks like when Godzilla is jumping in Godzilla Unleashed. And the mechanics of the jump actually work the exact same way, because they were here the whole time. So I want to talk a bit more about how this structure works, because it's important to understand how these two glitches work. And the first one I want to talk about is the best glitch to have ever happened that has eluded us Nasty Soft devs for years, called the Mechie Flip. Just watch. He flips. During the launch animation, something happens. During that initial burst of momentum, something happens where they flip in one direction or the other, and the direction also seems inconsistent. And while I was making the funny jump, it happened to me twice in the same day. And you can see this is before I imported the Godzilla Unleashed animations. He just does a duck squat. These are placeholders. And then he flips during it. And then this is just his laying down idol that I used as a placeholder before Great Godzilla God made the actual pose from the movie Megaguirus. And here it is. Here it is again. And I have no idea why this happens, but it's so glorious that it needs to be made consistent. And the other glitch I want to talk about is the slide. So this occurs, I'm going to tell you why I think it occurs, but you can see he preserves all of the momentum. Normally, when you cancel this attack into aerials, the momentum is cut short, and instead it transitions over to the normal momentum, the normal jump state I was talking about, where it's a set distance and the momentum doesn't normally transfer. But for some reason, some kind of glitch occurs where all of the momentum is transferred over, and it occurs in this clip as well. He gets sent super far and continues sliding even into his victory pose. And this is also what happens in this best of slot video 6 years ago, playing the Godzilla Unleashed overhaul mod I made. This is a throwback, but he says at one point, this is just amazing and is a huge inspiration for how STEM works. He says at one point, I'm just going to start mashing buttons and see what happens.
I'm just gonna press every button, right? If I press everything, eventually, good things will happen.
And he discovers wave dashing in Godzilla Unleashed. And I believe this is the exact same glitch that's occurring in Save the Earth Melee. So in terms of what is actually causing these two glitches to occur, I honestly don't know. I have a much better idea of what's occurring with the preserved momentum bug when you do aerial attacks than I do the monkey flip. but both I want to be recreatable. And I'm going to talk about the preservation of momentum first. So out of Godzilla's funny jump, before you actually do the jump, like so, if you hold A, X, or B, you can do your aerials while keeping a bit of that momentum going. And when you actually start to do your attack, the momentum cuts it. It gets cut short. It instead transfers over to a value of zero that these aerial attacks have with their momentum. And this is, I mean, I thought that this would be a really cool way to give the special ability some genuine utility outside of just get me out of here or a very funny hard read that does a lot of damage. Because basically you can do an aerial attack while you're standing, or while you do a run jump, or while you do the special ability, and it's slower to start up than a normal aerial, but you do get a significant burst of momentum. So it's a mix-up, right? And looking at this chart again, with the launch preparation, the rise upwards, and the fall down, midway through the launch preparation, it starts accepting inputs to do aerial attacks. And the aerial attacks can only happen at the very end of this launch, right? So this is an example of what it looks like. Before you actually go and enter into the Godzilla Unleashed rising animation, it cancels into an aerial. However, I put in a safety net for fat fingering or overcorrection, where at the very beginning of the rise upward state, there is also a check for those aerials, and it's only at the very beginning. So if I'm midway through the rising animation and I press A, I'm mashing A, nothing happens, right? But if I'm still in the launch and I press A, I'll do my jump attack, right? And also, at the end of this state and the beginning of this state, it calls the script for what is essentially self-inflicted knockback, right? And it does this twice, because it does it at the beginning, it does it at the beginning of the second state and the end of the first state. And I believe that this slide, I close all the tabs, but I believe that that slide is the result of inputting an aerial attack at the start of this and not at all during this. So it is an incredibly tight, frame-perfect execution. And I can further test that to see if it's true and then just make it a consistent part of the game. Obviously nerfing it, but the reason I added two of these bursts of momentum is so that when you do this, it doesn't go nearly as far as doing this. It's like a double burst, and something about that produces a glitch where you can get that slide. Now, the flip, I have no idea. It has eluded us for years, about 3 years. I only have theories, and these theories just simply can't be tested in any way. The first theory is that it is something to do with the terrain of the ground and where you're standing. Maybe if you're standing exactly on the terrain's model, if you're standing exactly on a vertice, it doesn't really know which way you're standing upward, or it has to do with the internal clock of the game. Just for some reason, every 60 frames, one of those frames just produces that result, and it's just completely random. And if either of those are the case, unfortunately I cannot make the monkey flip consistent, and that would be a very sad future indeed. But I'll look into it more, and I'll show you a bit of how the structure of this code actually works. So this is HXD. It's a hex editing program. And you need three things to work on a character. You need their bundle, and you need their monster data. Yeah, that'll work. And you need a list of their strings. And the reason you need a second file instead of just the monster file to work on is because the way that you navigate a file like this is through addresses and the offset of certain data types. That's how the computer, jumps from these points of this file. It jumps instantly by saying, this is a good example. This right here is an address. Read backwards, it's 10FCC. So if you go to the offset 10FCC, you are taken to this part, and I can just tell by looking at it, this is the normal idle for Godzilla 2000. And that's how you essentially jump around the bundle, and this is a list of all the strings that you have. And if you want to jump to any state or any particle or any animation, anything you want, you use the line number that this each one is on, because that is the order of the strings sequentially, and it uses integers to call these strings. So if I want to edit Godzilla's jump punch, that's line 433. So I look up the integer 433, make sure it's a 32-bit, and here is an animation block for that attack. And I can confirm that it is by checking out what this integer is, 289, and it's the animation for Godzilla's jump punch. So I've found it. And then I can copy this data over into the main bundle and begin editing certain values. And this is how you can string together different states, right? So Godzilla 2000, in normal Save the Earth, he doesn't have a special ability. When you're ducking like this and you press jump, nothing happens. So during the duck, I'm really getting ahead of myself. Again, I don't have a script to adhere to, but if I want to find and edit the funny jump again, obviously I want to write down all these offsets somewhere, copy them into a notepad document so I don't have to keep finding them. But if I lose that, then using context clues, you can find it quite easily by finding Godzilla's duck on line 152. And this is the animation block for the duck. And then you go to the beginning of it and you look up the offset. You see in this corner, the offset is 28.7c. So reverting that backwards, you look for 7c28. Here it is. This is the input block for the duck. And what that essentially is the actual state of ducking itself. So this is what I'm looking at, is when you're ducking. And below this state are all the inputs you can do out of ducking. So this is an example of an input. They're all a consistent length, and all these bytes, which look like nothing, but there are patterns, all these bytes determine what kind of state you can do out of duck, and what are the inputs to make it happen, what is its input priority, what part of the animation will these inputs register. And here's an example of what I mean by that. This float value is set to 0, and this float value is set to 2. So basically what this is saying, from the very beginning of the duck to the very end of the duck, this input will register. And that's pretty standard for a looping state like an idle or a duck or a block, right? And at the very beginning, if we go back to how we got here, this float value is 2. And this means the duck will loop for 2 seconds before looping again. So, this right here, just by looking at it, this is a single input where it determines if you are holding the left bumper, which is the block button, that's what OD is, and you release the left trigger, and you are not holding the left trigger, you'll go to block. You won't enter idle and then go to block, which would be slower. You go directly into block. And so I simply replaced a state out of duck that wasn't needed and found a way to put it back in without changing the file size and made it so that when you jump, you enter a brand new state. There's a lot more. There's a lot more to set up than just that, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to run and do it. So also during when you're running, if you press both triggers, it'll just happen. And that, you know, across all states, that's what I call them. Across all states in the bundle, you can input this consistently. So. Okay, let's go back to duck and let's find what it is. It's right here. It's right here because 0A is the right trigger. So this is detecting if you press the right trigger while holding the left trigger during his duck, you will enter into this state right here. So I'll look up in the monster data, 2B9BC. B9BC. And this is the launch initiation. So I'll just take some bytes and search for it. Okay, we found it in the main bundle. This is the launch initiation, and it's 0.45 seconds long. It's not too long. And here are 3 inputs that you can do out of it. And they are jump kick, that's X, 10 is X, 0F is B, so this is the jump tail attack, 0E is A, so this is the jump punch. And you can only do it at frame 0.45. So 0.45 seconds into this, you can do it, which is the end of the state. So you can't input and do a jump punch before Godzilla leaves the ground. That's basically what that is. And I also set it up. If we look up here, we can see if we don't input anything, at the end of 0.45 seconds, we'll go to this state naturally. We'll naturally transition. And that is the rise up. So 2963C. Takes us to this state, which is the rise up. And there's also a 10, a 0F, and a 0A, which again is X, B, and A. It's looking for if you're pressing those buttons on the controller. And you can only do this 0.03 seconds into this animation, which is 0.3 seconds long. So we can determine exactly how many frames that is. Time is 60. So that's a 1.74 frame window, which I'm sure just rounds up to 2. I'm not exactly sure. So it's a 1 or 2 frame input. That's a very tight execution. Anybody who plays fighting games knows that that's a very tight execution. But I'm just going to attempt to see what happens if I make it 0.1, which is a 6-frame input, which is much more doable. Just to not mess it up, I might just make it 0.3. I might make it the entire length of the rise up just to see what happens. And it will likely look incredibly janky. I'm just going to make a backup of Godzilla 2000. If we go to the file location, I'm just going to make a backup here. So I'm going to save this. And this is how you test changes in game, is you have to rebuild the entire archive of all the files in the game. It's going through fight music, stuff like that. And then it is created here in a Godzilla.volume. You put that into an ISO rebuild folder. Then you need a program called ImageBurn. This essentially just turned into a tutorial on how to mod Godzilla Save the Earth. And then you choose an output file. I'm going to name this ISO Godzilla 2K Test. Then you burn it. Then you go to PCSX2. Godzilla 2K test, swap the disk over, and then so now that I've recreated the ISO, going in game, we can test out the changes that we made, and we'll just see what happens if I input an aerial attack during that rise up. It looks very janky, right? Because I warp back down to the ground because I'm a set distance. And I can now rule out that it is in fact a frame perfect input, because if that were true, then I would preserve my momentum from the rise up to these aerial attacks, but that's clearly not happening. So it may also be an indeterminate glitch where we can't figure out what's going on, which is unfortunate, but that's essentially a breakdown of how this move works and how you mod Save the Earth. It's a very time-consuming process, but it's worth it. It's a pretty fun game. And that's essentially all I wanted to talk about with the funny jump and how it works, how states work in this game, and how you can jump around a file. And I don't expect anybody watching to understand what the hell I just did. I will make tutorials in the future. But as you can see, I'm really gonna have to figure out where to begin with them and how to convey all the knowledge I know about Save the Earth modding in a digestible format. I mean, it's essentially like teaching a class. It's probably going to have to be several videos long. But that should be a good introduction to just show you the kind of stuff you can do. So I'm going to end this with one more test, one more little change, and that is I am going to make, let's say, this attack is back A. I'm going to make this incredibly fast and spammable. So, left A, it's probably just called overhand 497. Located it. We're going to go to the beginning of the block, and this is the play rate of the animation. It's right now at 0.58. And essentially, if we increase this value, then we increase how fast the animation plays for. So this is how fast I want it to be, 0.58. It's decently slow, strong overhead. Let's set it to 3 or maybe 2.5. And then we also have to go to the input and decrease the length of the attack relative to how much we increased the play rate. No. I don't remember the exact equation. It doesn't matter. We're going to make it so spammable and so fast that it will be quite funny.
Very quickly, I remembered the equation. You divide whatever the play rate is. You do 1 divided by this new play rate. Got 0.4, which is really close to what I guessed anyway. But that is how you find what the perfect new move length would be. And interjecting, this is how you can decrease end lag, is instead of putting it at 0.4, you might put it at 0.33 and see how that feels, and then tweak it from there.
So now we are back in the game, and we're going to test our changes. We're going to see what that overhand attack looks like now. Well, yep, it's quite fast, quite spammable. That's kind of funny. So fast it doesn't even hit. So that's basically how it's done. It's a lot of trial and error, getting things to feel right, and then you go back, you close the game, you go back into the bundle, and you make some more edits, and he's already dead. I hope you enjoyed this video. It was quite a long one. And I'll see you in the next Dev Diary.